Come on, really put your hands together for Jesus. God is good all the time. All the time the Lord is good. Can you say amen?
Amen.
Amen. Now let me just give God some praise for you as a church, as a people. You have been a blessing. Can you say amen?
Amen.
Amen. I thank God for you. I want to tell you, Safis, you are a good church. Now, I said that because I'm your pastor, and I have a responsibility to say to you, you're a great church. You are a great church. Can you say amen? I'm blessed to be in this place. Amen? Amen. Psalms 23. Psalms 23. Y'all pray for me. Not just today, but pray for me. Me and the family. Can you say amen?
Amen?
Amen. God is good all the time. All the time the Lord is good. I wanted to preach another piece, and I thought about maybe somebody may be right here going through this situation right now. And, you know, I was at a funeral with Sister Mary Ann yesterday and that family. And when the minister spoke those words, it was almost an anointed moment. I said, Lord, whatever you're going to do, will you please do it? Because you never know what people are going through. You really don't know. Amen. And I just pray that the Lord blesses your spirit today. Can you say amen? Now let me read this verse in your spirit. Yea, Psalm 23, verse 4. Though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil. For you are with me. Your rod, your staff, they comfort me. Let me read it one more time for you. Yea, or even though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil. For you are with me. Your rod, your staff, they comfort me. Can you say amen? You may be seated. Father, I come again. Lord, you know where we are. Some are in valleys, in dark places in their lives. Father, I ask in the name of Jesus that you would begin to speak to them and say to them, it is not the end. It is not over. I'm not through with you yet. I pray, God, that you would give hope to the heart. You would allow, oh God, the soul to see the solace of this moment, to know that even in valleys there can be victories. There are some who sit here broken, torn, tattered. Life does not look all that great for them. But I ask in Jesus' name, you stop by just a little while. Fix it, Jesus. And when you fix it, it will be fixed. Touch, Jesus. When you touch, they will be touched. Lay your hand on some. Breathe on others. However you choose to move, I surrender, Lord. I surrender to your power. Because you are God. You are our refuge. A very present help in the time of trouble. You're a refreshment. You're our river that never runs dry. Help us in our most broken moments to remember that you are a mighty God. You can do anything but fail. Thank you now. I want to say thank you because you've been so good to me. I want to thank you, Lord, for your many blessings in my life. I humbly say I'm not worthy. I know I didn't do nothing to deserve it, but it's been your hand, been your favor, your grace, your goodness. You poured it all over me. You strengthened me on the inside and you strengthened me on the outside. And really what I am is not what I look like, because it's you that's walking with me. It's you that's holding me. It's you that's keeping me. You are my company keeper. Thank you right now. Thank you for just surrounding me with people who have spoken into my spirit and allowed me to know that everything will be all right. Now, God, I want to just honor you for this church and the people that sit here, those who love your name, those who call on your name, who depend on your name, who understand that they've been covered by the blood of Jesus. The walking up the King's highway. Can I just say thank you, Lord? Thank you for the older ones, but thank you for the younger ones. Thank you for a church, God, that you have blessed in amazing ways. I just bless your name today. Now, Father, would you lead us through Scripture? Lead us and guide us and speak to us in every way. How I love you. How I plead your presence. The illuminating power of the Holy Spirit. In Jesus' name. Can you say amen? Amen, amen, amen. God is good. I want to talk about God's antidote to dark valleys. Touch your neighbor and say, God's antidote to dark valleys. There is a strategic change in the psalmist when he says, yea, or even though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil, for you are with me. Your rod and your staff, they comfort me. The change he is talking about is a personal relationship in verse 1. The Lord is my shepherd. God's provisions in verses 2 and 3, but in verse 4, he talks about God's protection. He says, though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil, for you are with me. With me in every situation. With me in every dark trial. With me in every dismal disappointment. With me in every distressing dilemma. You are with me. The change is a confident personal response in what his shepherd will do. The change is this in the first three verses, all of the pronouns are in the third person. Are you with me here? He is talking about God, but when he gets in the valley, he is talking to God. He is not describing God in the third person, but he is describing God in the first person, which means he is confident that God is actually in the valley with him. The ultimate becomes the intimate. Religion becomes a relationship. Belief becomes reality. Are you with me here? The psalmist is accurate, because when people are not going through tough times, they all have theories about God. Are you with me here? But when you go through tough times, you develop not theories, but you develop testimonies about what your God can do. There is an Arab proverb that says, all sunshine and no rain makes a desert. That would suggest that if there are no bad times, there are no dark times, there are no valid times in your life, you are going to dry up. You have to go through valleys in order to mature. God is going to give you valleys. He's going to give me valleys, because he wants to do something in our lives. What do we need to remember when we are in a dark valley? Well, the first thing that I need to tell you, you need to remember when you're in a dark valley, is valleys are inevitable. Are you with me here? In this world, you will have trouble. You're going to have trouble as long as you are in this world. It's not if, but it's when it will happen. There will always be valleys in your life. You're going to go through sickness, sorrow, and suffering. You're going to go through fear, failure, and fatigue. It happens to all of us. It happens to the best of us. But not only are valleys inevitable, but valleys are unpredictable. Jeremiah 4:20 says, disaster follows disaster. In an instant, tents are destroyed. My shelter falls in a moment. You can't plan them. You can't time them. You can't schedule them. Valleys will happen to you. They are unpredictable. They usually come at the most inopportune time, when your back is up against the wall, when there is no sugar in your coffee, when there is no spare in your trunk, no extra money in your wallet. They are unpredictable. But not only are valleys unpredictable, but valleys are impartial. Consider what James says in James 1 verses 2 and 4. Consider it pure joy, my brother, whenever you face trials of many kinds, because you know that he's testing, it is the testing of your faith that develops perseverance. Perseverance must finish its work so that you may be mature and complete and not lacking anything. Valleys are impartial. No one is immune from them. We all have to face them. No one is isolated from the pain of them. We all have to go through them. Everybody goes through a valley. Good people and bad people go through a valley because they are impartial. Does that mean that you are a bad person? It means bad things can happen to anybody because valleys are impartial. Dark valleys and disappointments are impartial. They will hit and happen to everybody in this room. But not only are valleys impartial, but valleys are developmental. Touch your neighbor and say developmental. 1 Peter 1:6-7 says, in this you greatly rejoice, even though now for a little while, if necessary, you have been distressed by various trials. So that the proof of your faith, being more precious than gold, which is perishable, even though tested by fire, may be found in results in praises and glory and honor at the revelation of Jesus Christ. Valleys are developmental. In other words, child of God, God has a reason for allowing you to go through your valley. God has a reason for allowing you to go through disappointment. God has a reason for allowing you to go through distressing moments. God has a reason for allowing you to go through failure, even fatigue in your life. God doesn't waste any pain in your life. He has a reason for allowing you to experience certain things in your life. Listen, valleys sometimes are disappointing. They create doubt. They make you feel defeated and despair. But God is behind it. God has a reason for everything. And his reason is the genuineness of your faith. In other words, child of God, if you're going through something, all you got to say to yourself is, the Lord is working on me. He's not through with me yet. There's still some things in my life that God has to deal with, because really sometimes we don't want to face it. We don't want to let them go. But God is working on your faith, and God wants to build up your faith. Have I got somebody? We love mountaintop experience, but God doesn't build faith in the mountaintop experience. God builds your faith in the valley. And you're in the valley because God is working on your faith. God is trying to make you better in your situation, better for life, and better for the next thing that's coming your way. Three things that the valley develops in you. Number one, the valley develops confidence in God. See, child of God, God will send you through things because God is saying, you've got to trust me more. There are things in our life we've been trusting in, but those things are not the things that have been sustaining us. Have I got a witness here? And what God will do, he will remove what you've been trusting in so you can see him clearly. That's why Isaiah said, in the year King Uzziah died, I saw the Lord. He was high and lifted up. There's some things that are blocking God's view. And whatever is in your life that's blocking God's view, God has a way of moving those things. Whether it be your money or your honey, God has a way of moving whatever in his way. That when he's finished, all you can say is, I will trust in the Lord. And child of God, don't you know you've got to trust in God? Wherever you may be, on the land or on the stormy seas, God has a way of laying you on your back, and the only thing you can do is look up and say, God, I trust you. God can put you in a situation, and the only thing you can do is say, God, I know you're able, I know you can, and I know you will work it out. You might as well talk to me now. Because God has somebody in the valley in this room. And what God is saying, you got to trust him right where you are. Listen, confidence in God. But not only confidence in God, but character in yourself. Compassion for others. Are you with me here? Not only are valleys developmental, but valleys are temporal. Touch your neighbor, say, you can shout about this. In this you greatly rejoice, even though now for a little while, if necessary, you have been distressed by various trials. Valleys are like storms. Storms pass over. Valleys you pass through. Storms cover the sun. Valleys cut off the sun. Storm is above you. The valley is beneath you. No one loves them. They are not a permanent location. That's why David says, though I walk through the valley. Have I got somebody? Touch your neighbor and say, you're not there to stay. You're going through something right now. But I got good news for you. This too shall pass. But God's going to let you go through it for a while. As a matter of fact, God's going to put you in the valley for a while till you learn to trust him. Have I got somebody? God's going to put you in the valley for a while because you've got some things in you. He's got to get out of you. Have I got somebody? Then God's going to send you to a valley for a while. Because when you come out that valley, you're going to have a testimony to tell somebody that I know the Lord will work it out. I know God is able. Somebody's going to be in a valley. But you're going to be able to talk to them about that valley and say, I've been there and I've done that. But this one thing I do know, the same God that delivered me is the same God that can deliver you. Have I got a witness here? Maybe you need to tell your story today. Somebody needs to know what God has done in your life today. Somebody needs to understand that their situation isn't all that big. That you serve a God that can work it out. Listen, I'm talking to somebody. Sometimes it feels like the end, but it's not the end. Sometimes you think you're going to die, but you're not going to die. Sometimes it feels like it's over, but it's not over. And like storms, valleys do cease. This will cease. It will come to an end. Have I got a witness here? Listen, child of God, what do you do when you're in the valley? Are you with me here? Somebody's in the valley this morning. You need to talk to me. What do you do when you're in the valley? Listen, recount your response before you get to the valley. Listen to David. Even though I walk. Are you with me here? Recount means to enumerate, to repeat, to rehearse, to say it over and over again, to count it as a fact. You see, this verse is in the future tense. So David is rehearsing his response. He's not in the valley. He's rehearsing before he gets in the valley. Have I got a witness here? Maybe we need to rehearse this morning. Why don't you say it with me? Yea, though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil, for you are with me. Every time, child of God, you come up on a valley, before you get in the valley, you need to say, yea, though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil, for you are with me. You just keep on saying before you get to the valley. And when you're in the valley, you'll recognize God is right there with you. That's why we used to teach our children to say, stop, drop, and roll. You know how it goes, stop, drop, and roll. Because when that fire hits you, you normally resort to your natural instinct. But if you practice it, if you rehearse it, have I got a witness here? When that fire hits you, you will stop, drop, and roll. And what God is saying, when you get to that valley, you got to stop, drop, and roll. I'll be with you in the fire. Have I got somebody? I'm with you in the storm. Have I got somebody? When the rain comes, I'm right there. That's the kind of God we serve. Watch me. I gotta teach this a minute. Turn over to James. Turn over to James. James 1. Let me read you a few verses. Let me read it to your spirit. To your spirit. My brethren, my sisterin. I'm a Baptist preacher. I can make up a word. Count it all joy when you fall into various trials, knowing that the testing, that's a participle, because your faith is not going to be test, there will be some testing of your faith. Are you with me here? Of your faith produces patience, or we would say perseverance. Are you with me here? But, listen to him now, don't you get off Monday, but you're being tested, but that's the contrast. Are you with me there? Let, you're going through something, but let perseverance have its perfect work, that you may be perfect, complete, and lacking nothing. Are you with me here? Now watch. Frustration and disappointment are part of life. But how they affect us is basically our choice. We can allow a disappointment to hamper us, destroy us, or even destroy major decisions in our lives. But another response is to accept, listen to me, disappointment. Accept hurt and discover what we can learn from it, and then make some new plans or new alternatives. Can I bring it to you just a little bit closer? See, when you're going through some, God is saying, I'm getting ready to do a new thing. I'm getting ready to go in a new direction. Are you with me here? So what you need to look at when you're going through all this pain and hurt, to understand God is getting ready to do a new thing. Pastor, how do you know that? Well, the word count or consider means an internal attitude of heart and mind that causes the trial or circumstance of life to affect a person either adversely or beneficially. I said either adversely or beneficially. In other words, child of God, you can say what's happening to me right now is going to be a blessing. But you got to say it by faith. What I'm going through right now, God's going to bless me in my situation. Are you with me right here? Another interpretation of this word could be, make up your mind to regard adversity as something to welcome or be glad about. In other words, look at your storm and say thank you. Look at your disappointment and say thank you. Look at your frustration and say thank you. Look at what's happening to you right now and say, I accept it because I serve a God that can take a crooked stick and make a straight link. I serve a God that can turn a valley into a victory. Are you with me here? That's what he's saying. Now watch this now. He says, now watch this. It's an attitude of your mind. You got to have it made up in your mind. Listen, the word trial means outward trouble or stress or disappointment, sorrow, or hardship. There are situations that you had no part in bringing about. They are not seen. They just happen. We call them vicissitudes. They're things that just happen in life. Life is full of swift transition. It just happened to you. Have I got somebody? They include all of the various sorts of trouble that we find ourselves in as human beings. You ask yourself, how did I get here? Why did this happen to me? Why am I going through such a tough time in my life? What God is trying to say to you is that I'm getting ready to do something, but I needed some tough time to work it out in your life. Are you with me here? Lord, what am I supposed to do? The book says, he uses this word, endure.
or be patient. Huh? See, when God get to working on you, it don't always feel good. But endure and be patient. It means, it's translated the word fortitude. It's the quality of stabilizing or remaining alive when you're going through it. Are you with me here? It is, in a sense, a picture of standing firm under pressure rather than trying to escape. Are you with me here? I used this morning the illustration of a car wash. You know, sometimes we take our dirty cars to a car wash. Huh? And you know how they clean that dirt off our cars? They use a pressure gun to knock all the dirt off. Have I got a witness here? Now we could say, I'm not sending my car through all that water pressure. But if you don't go through the water pressure, the dirt ain't coming off. But when you go through the water pressure and they put the dirt, knock it off with all that water pressure, that soap and everything, all them flaps be hitting your car and just, you know, your car goes. But when it gets on the other side, have I got somebody? That dirty car that went through all that pressure and detergent and flaps is clean now. And God works the same way. Sometimes he has to send us through something. On one side, we're dirty. On one side, we're messed up. But when we go through, have I got somebody? We can come out like pure gold. Baby, just touch your neighbor and say, God is sending you through something. But after a while, and by, when the morning comes, you about to come out like pure gold. Trust him. Don't complain, just remain confident. Don't fear, have faith. Don't be horrified, just hope in God. Are you with me here? Listen, you got to refuse to be discouraged. Some folks just think it's just their job to say something smart to you. That's their job, to paint a bleak picture. But you got to refuse to be discouraged. Touch your neighbor and say, I refuse to be discouraged. The first thing you have to remember is you need to refuse to quit. I won't quit. You can quit or fight. I choose to fight. Have I got somebody? Listen to David. He said, though I walk through the valley, I'm telling you, don't quit. Most of us quit before we walk through something and later discover it was a bad decision. Don't quit. God's got something better for you. Valleys are not dead end streets. You're gonna have some disappointment. You're gonna have some frustration. You're gonna have some discouragement, dilemmas. There are gonna be some dark, difficult days. But though you go through these things, they will not last long. God has something more on the other side. It's just a mere shadow. Are you with me here? Though I walk through the valley, preposition of the shadow of death, it's just a shadow. You know, a shadow is just a reflection. There really is no real image. It's a reflection of a mirror image. And sometimes the devil threatens us with just a shadow. Have I got somebody? But God says, keep walking and don't quit. Listen. There are three things you need to know about shadows. Shadows are bigger than they appear. You ever seen a shadow? Sometimes your shadow can be 20 feet long. You know you ain't number 4 feet. Shadows cannot hurt you. It's just a shadow. What God is saying, it won't hurt you. So you need to realize what you're going through is not going to hurt you. And wherever there is a shadow, there's always some light. Have I got somebody? I said, every time you see a shadow, there has to be some light. So if you see the shadow of death, you know there's some light somewhere around. So though you're walking through this situation, know that God is holding up the light for you to see your way throughout this valley. Have I got somebody? I got the rush. I'm running. Remember Remember, God is with you.
Yes, he is.
For you are with me. Isaiah 43 and 2 says, when you go through deep waters, when you go through great trouble, I will be with you. Most of us say, if God is with me, then why am I going through this valley? But when we really, what we really need to remember is that God can turn our trouble into triumph. He can turn our valleys into victory. It doesn't need, listen, that doesn't need to be the absence of trouble for God to bless you. God can bless you in any situation. I want that to sink in. I don't care what you're going through. I don't care how it looks. God can bless you in any situation. He can lay his hand on anything and bless you. As a matter of fact, God made you out of dust. Have I got somebody? And breathed into dust and made you a living soul. God can bless any situation. Watch me now. I'm going to give you one more. We're going to quit here. Rely on God's protection. Your rod, I'm in the valley, and your staff comforts me. Rods were a shepherd too, made for a shepherd for protection and discipline. For the shepherd to examine and count his sheep. And then there is the phrase of terminology, passing under the rod. Because he would be examining or counting his sheep as they passed under the rod. That's where we get the phrase, you can't pull the wool over my eyes. See, God has a rod. He examines you all the time. He knows that you're there because he's counting to see if you're present or not. You can't pull the wool over God's eyes. He knows where you are. He knows what you're going through. Both rod and staff function to comfort. And listen, the staff was a primary tool that the shepherd used for comforting his sheep. And so this shepherd tool had basically three functions. See, God's staff has three functions in your life. When God has the staff over your life, it's for intimate relationships. Because sometimes you wander off and God takes his staff and just brings you on back. Have I got somebody? But not only is for intimate relationships, but sheep have a tendency of falling over. And when they fall over, they can't get up. They roll over on their back. And so the shepherd sometimes can take his staff and lift you up back on your feet. Are you with me here? But that staff remains with the shepherd. And wherever the shepherd goes, the sheep follow that staff. So the staff was used for guidance. Have I got somebody? God knows how to bring us close to him. God knows how to lift us up. And God knows how to guide us in dark valleys. Your rod and your staff, they comfort me. I'm confident in the valley because I can get close to you. I'm confident in the valley because you will lift me up. I'm confident in the valley because I know you will guide me through this situation. Now I'm through. What happens when you're in that valley? I got three things and I'm through. Number one, it brings you closer to God. You in the valley? Are you in a valley? It's going to bring you closer to God. God ain't telling you to go hit the nightclub. That's not what he's saying. God ain't telling you you need another drink. I know you're drinking, but you don't need another drink. Have I got a witness here? God ain't telling you need to look for love in the wrong places and the wrong faces. But God is saying, I need you closer to me. That's what you really need. You're never going to have an ease of mind, or you're never going to have peace of mind until you get closer to God. All that stuff and things won't fill the void that God wants to fill in your life. Are you with me here? Listen, believers sooner or later discover that when they're in the valley, you can find refreshment. See, God knows how to refresh your soul even when you're going through frustration. God knows how to lift you up when you're going through a bad situation. So God will let you know that while you're in the valley, you can find some refreshment. Here's what I want to tell you. When you're in the valley, and while you're in the valley, God will give you strength. Don't you know he will? When you're going through a difficult moment, you'll find strength beyond yourself. Not only will God strengthen you on the inside, but God will strengthen you on the outside. Folk will be looking at you. They can't tell what you're going through because there's a light of glow on your life because God laid his hands on you. Have I got a witness here? Things might be messed up all around you, but you know that God is walking with you. God's hands is upon you. Your health might be bad, but folk can't tell because the Lord has laid his hands on you. Your money might be funny, but folk can't tell because God has laid his hands on you. God knows how to strengthen you in your situation. I praise God because God has let me know, despite what I'm going through, despite what I experience in my life, God is able to pick me up in my situation and give me the strength I need to make it. Have I got somebody in this house? I love the Lord because he heard my cry and pitied every groan. As long as I live and trouble rides, I'll haste unto his throne. God has a way of blessing you in your brokenness. God has a way of picking you up when you're down. God has a way of bringing you up when you're going through. He will do it. Yes, he can. And yes, he will.
Straight Jesus.